Hey, how is everybody? Great to have you on board. Looks like we got people from all around the world joining us. So thanks so much. Hi, I'm Dan Bova at Entrepreneur, and thanks for joining us for another installment of Ask Marc. As you regulars know, we have Marc Randolph, the co-founder and founding CEO of Netflix, here to answer your questions live. Now, Marc has mentored hundreds of early-stage entrepreneurs. He hosts the That Will Never Work podcast. He's an investor on our show, Entrepreneur Elevator Pitch. The man knows what he's talking about, and I have yet to see him get stumped by any of your questions. Will today be the day? So fire away with anything you'd like to ask in the chat. We've got a bunch of questions that already came in via social media, so let's get to it. Marc, are you out there? Are you ready?
I'm ready to go, Dan, but I'm not quite sure how I feel about you challenging people and trying to stump me.
Well, that might be a little unfair. I should add, Marc, we really do appreciate this. Marc has COVID, but he is still here. He's still doing this. He's still answering your questions. That's how much he cares. So thanks, Marc. We appreciate it.
My as long as he excuses me occasionally coughing and the fact that I'm unshaven. That's my
If only I had an excuse. But here we go. Marc, let's get right into it. What do you say?
Sounds good. Bring it on.
All right. Excellent. So let's go to our list of questions. We've got one that just came in from John Thompson. This is about finance. How many financial details do you need before you pitch an angel investor, especially if you haven't launched the product?
So if you haven't launched the product, having the financial details is not that important. Because if you have not yet launched the product, what are you going to do? You're going to do that classic hockey stick where you go, here it is. There's year one, year two, year three, and look at this, year five. And it's like a huge, or even the worst one is the TAM, the total addressable market slide, where you go, look, it's a $56 billion market. And all we have to do is get 1%. In other words, if you haven't launched yet, it's almost all going to be bullshit. So don't. Instead, talk about what it is you have learned, which gives you confidence that this is going to work. And so when you say haven't launched yet, I'm assuming that means you have not yet collided your idea with real people. But if launch means you haven't formally put it out, but that you do have data that you've accumulated through secondary means, then I change my answer. Then it's as much financial detail as you can. A lot of times, for example, you won't have, let's just take a simple one. Let's say you have an app. So your app isn't ready yet. So you're faking it. You're basically just using a website and you're basically doing everything in the background manually. So that's okay because you can still say, I've learned what it costs me to acquire a customer. I've learned what the conversion rate is between someone who lands here and someone who ultimately says they're going to download the app, even though when they hit download, it says put yourself on a waiting list. I've learned all the different price point analysis work that I've done. Notice what an investor wants to see is not the hand waving and the imagine, if you will. What they want to hear is what do you know? What are you confident about? How clearly do you understand what I don't know? How well can you articulate what this money you're going to be asking for is going to accomplish and how you're going to know when you get there? So both ways. If you have data, the more data you can show them, the better. If you don't have data, don't make it up. Don't put in place estimates and guesses and forecasts and projections because I'll tell you, at least from my perspective, no one believes you. Instead, what we're trying to get a sense of when we hear a pitch is, does this person have their hands on the wheel? Do they understand the customer? Do they know the problem they're trying to solve? Do they know what the risks are? What is this round going to do? How will they know if they're successful? That's what you want to go in prepared to present and ask for.
Excellent. Excellent. Didn't stump them yet. So let's keep going. Let's see what we can do. Well, you know, going off that topic, so Sitil Mukherjee is wondering, you know, for first timers, you know, we talk about what investors want to see, what they want to hear, but how do you start? How do you get in front of an investor to begin with?
So getting in front of an investor means starting those relationships early. And as we just finished saying, when you finally go in and sit down to pitch, you kind of need to have your act together. You need to have understood things. But there's a lot of work you can do before that point. You want to establish a relationship. You want to identify which investors are actually fluent in the category you're trying to address. If you know that someone, you do your research and you know, oh, this firm only does SaaS, then don't pitch them some hardware robotics thing and vice versa. So first one is you do this research and you know which firms may invest in the type of business you're building, which partner has some expertise in that, and then establish that relationship early. And the best way I've found to do that is reach out. The way these people work is they thrive on relationships too. It's very rare that they will say, no, I do not have time to meet you. I mean, you may get the first round, you may get an associate rather than a partner, but that's reasonable. But you can certainly reach out and say, hey, you know, I'm working on something. Here's the important phrase. We are not raising right now, but I'd love to come down and just sit down with you for a minute and kind of explain what it is we're working on and kind of the direction we're going. And here's the next part, and get your feedback on whether I'm heading in the right direction. I'd love to ask you, what are the metrics that you like to see before you're ready to make an investment? And so by having these early meetings, and believe me, they're not going to say no. Nobody wants to be the guy who didn't take the meeting with the next Airbnb or the next Uber. And this allows you to not only get them to understand who you are, begin establishing a relationship early, but it's a chance to genuinely get some real intelligence about what are they looking for. And they'll tell you very directly, we don't invest until you have, or this is what we like to see. And that can be extremely clarifying for you. So it's as simple as that. You identify all the possible people that you might want to talk to. You begin narrowing it down by what firms work on the type of, I mean, not in firms, it could be angels. What angels are involved in the category that you're in? Which partners or which people specifically understand those categories? And then reach out to them and say, let's talk. Will you do coffee with me? Will you meet me for a beer? And it's amazing how well that works. And then one last little tip, one last little hack. What I found is something interesting is you can get in their face other ways besides trying to reach out through LinkedIn or through email. You can begin commenting on their tweets. You can begin commenting on their LinkedIn posts. You can begin in, you can be deep in the comment sections on their blog posts. And the first time you'll be just one of many, but after a while they'll begin to going, who is this dollhouse 741 or whatever you're, and that all of a sudden, so when you finally reach out to them, you'll in some ways already have established a relationship with them.
That's great. That's great. Dollhouse. What was that? What was that?
Dollhouse 741. I'm just kind of up in the attic right now. I'm going, what's a ridiculous username that somebody might have? And it's a dollhouse right over here.
That's perfect.
I made up the 741 part though.
Okay. Okay. So we've got a couple of questions that all are touching in the same realm, which is basically what you're doing right now, which is speaking to a large group of people, and you're doing it pretty confidently. You've got some experience and some well-earned confidence. But for people who aren't so confident, like how do you suggest people sort of build that muscle of talking to people? Maybe it's not a ton of people at once, but even just talking to, you know, people on the other side of a table sometimes can really like send someone into a nervous panic.
No, it is absolutely the case. especially when you're trying to talk about entrepreneurial stuff, which by definition is you talking about things which, quite frankly, you do not yet know if they're going to work. So it's not at all unusual to be nervous or scared, because nobody wants to make an ass of themselves. No one wants to do something they don't know if it's going to work. Like anything, the only way you get better at this, and I know this is trite, but it's so true, is practice. You have to do it. And the way you do it is you start small. Let's say you're trying to get your nerve up to do a pitch. You do not want the very, very first time you pitch your idea to be in front of your local investment club, where there's an audience of 40 people out there, each of whom has their checkbook in their hand. You want to start by pitching to every single person that you can find who are non-consequential, to your friends, to your family, to your neighbors, to the UPS guy when he comes to the door. I mean, any opportunity you have to practice forming your thoughts, presenting them out loud, is valuable. I mean, fundamentally here, the goal is to be bold, not perfect. I mean, I'll give you a perfect example here. So I like languages. And one of my claims to fame is that I suck in 6 different languages. I suck in Latin, I suck in Russian, I suck in French, I suck in Italian, and English, but I don't suck that much in English. But what I learned from being bad at all those languages is that you don't learn them by learning vocabulary and learning grammar and all that stuff. You learn them by having the courage to be in a different country and walk up to the counter in the coffee shop and open your mouth and have something come out that sounds like you're 4 years old. That is how you learn a language. That is how you learn to present. That is how you learn to make your case, is by being willing to not do it right the first time and practice, practice, practice. But one more piece to this. It probably is the most important skill you can learn as an entrepreneur. Way more than learning how to code, way more than getting your MBA, way more than having finance or a marketing degree. We are hardwired as human beings to respond to stories. That is how we have, over the millennia, communicated with each other. And into that ability to communicate is such a fundamentally important thing. You're going to need it to convince anybody to join your cause, whether it's giving you the money, whether it's convincing someone to join you, whether it's convincing someone not to quit, whether it's communicating with clarity and confidence that this is where we're going, even if you're not in fact that clear or that confident. That is such a fundamental skill. You cannot start soon enough on getting good at that.
Excellent. Excellent. So Marc, we're getting a lot of thank yous in the chat. People are very appreciative of you here. People say you look great. So I wanted to pass that along. right on cue. So
I'm a little hard to swallow. That's all.
So one question Sai had was about What are some of the pillars? What are some of the things you look at in the early stages of an idea or a business to know, should we keep pursuing this or this is not going good? What are some of the factors that send you one way or another?
I'm looking for runaway success. And I don't mean writ large. I mean writ small. You know, there's this classic case, and I'm trying to remember who the justice of the Supreme Court was who said it, but they were talking about pornography and about trying to come up with pornography laws. And we said, basically, the problem, pornography, you know, it's really hard to define, but you know it when you see it. And product market fit is the same way. Really hard to define what that means, but you know it when you see it. So what I'm looking for are those know it when you see it moments when something you've tried, wow, it works remarkably well. I mean, there's times when, yes, I'm doing fracking where I'm basically trying hundreds of things to try and get very, very incremental improvements. But for the most part, what I'm doing is when I try all kinds of crazy shit, is I'm looking for one of them to leapfrog above everything else, to be like the Michael Jordan of ideas and be so obviously dominant that I know that is it. And the reason I'm looking for that is that, as we all know, startups are hard. I mean, nature conspires against them. Anything that can go wrong will go wrong. So unless you have these things which work really well, they will not survive that process, that survival of the fittest thing that startups have to go through. So I'm looking not for, did this beat it by a teeny little fraction? I'm looking for these runaway things, and I'll keep trying things. And not to go off on a whole other tangent, but I spend very little time beating on an idea. I do not second guess myself and go, oh, I guess I just didn't test this right. Or maybe I should have worded that differently. No, listen, even with my half-assed implementation of whatever I was trying, if it was going to work, it would have worked. And done with that one, on to the next one.
That's great. So we'll keep moving along here, because we don't want to keep you too long. We don't want you keeling over in the middle of this. But speaking of, you know, getting the word out and things like that, a couple of questions came in. One from Jamila Stokes: how did you build brand awareness and get others to buy into what you were doing when you were building Netflix? Big question. How do you get people to recognize what you're doing?
Yeah, it is really a challenge, because each successive year that gets harder and harder. And that's because each successive year that goes by, you have to start earlier and earlier. And you know, people are now taking huge risks. They're gambling on things that haven't yet happened yet. So you've got to do creative things. And you know, perfect opportunity for a plug. In my book, That Will Never Work, Birth of Netflix, An Amazing Life of an Idea, out in paperback now, I have a whole chapter on all the things that I really had to do to try and get awareness of a company which did DVDs by mail at a time when almost nobody owned a DVD player. I mean, I could not do things like television, because 99.99% of the impressions would have landed on people who didn't have DVD players. I had to be really, really creative and go, how do I reach audiences of the people who might resonate with what I'm trying to do? And in this case, and the second piece to that was really being careful about identifying what is the unique value proposition here. What is the one thing I do that no one else does, even if I have to very narrowly define it? My product's great. It does 60 things, but I'm going to tell you about two of them, and I'm going to cleverly pick the two which there's no one else in the world that does, purely so I can find those couple people who have that problem and know that if I can reach them, they're going to have to buy from me. And just going back with a little bit of Netflix history, the challenge back then was there was nobody who owned DVD players. There was brand new, a brand new technology. There was probably less than 200,000 DVD players in the entire country. And the reason they were having a very hard time selling DVD players is because none of the video stores were renting DVDs. And the reason no one was renting DVDs was, what do you know, there's no DVD players. There was this chicken and egg problem. And one of the clever things, if I can pat myself on the back, was that we realized we actually can solve this problem for both sides. And I went and pitched to the DVD manufacturers and said, I can solve your problem. Just put a sticker on every box that says, if you buy this DVD player, we will guarantee you access to every single DVD available through Netflix. Get three free rentals, or 10 free rentals, or 5 free rentals, whatever I could negotiate. And once we managed, and I managed to convince pretty much every single consumer electronics company to do that deal. And that really was the thing that landed us into the consciousness, because we were catching people right at that moment of peak excitement. I just bought my $2,000 DVD player. I need some DVDs. And Netflix to the rescue.
That's great. Wow. I didn't know that. That's awesome. I got to read that book. I hear it's pretty good.
Dan, you better be kidding.
Yeah, I am kidding. So we've got a question from Sachin Sile. His question is about you. What were you up to as a teenager? But I think maybe more broadly is if you could speak to the teenage entrepreneurs out there, you know, what are you seeing? What are you seeing as opportunities for them? Have you met anyone recently that just really blew you away with a new take on something you hadn't thought of?
So listen, if I'm going to give an answer to reach out and give a message to teenagers, it's going to be the most Netflix advice of all, which is chill, you know, relax, don't worry, take your time. And, you know, you can say, what was I doing in my teenage years? But I was doing the same thing until I was 30. You know, I didn't move to California until I was 30. I didn't get into tech until I was 32. I was a geology major in college. I had a 2.7 GPA. You know, I was not on this track driven and focused from the very beginning. I was basically following my curiosity. I was taking whatever courses were interesting. I was doing entrepreneurial stuff, but it wasn't starting companies. I was, you know, doing school magazines. I was putting on plays. I was starting outing clubs. I was doing all these things, which to me were these recognitions that I saw this hole and I go, I'm going to try and fill that hole. And what a surprise that the skills required to do that, even when I was 13, 15, 17, 19, 21, whatever it was, were the exact same skills that I would use many years later. I would have to convince people to come help me for no money, but just for the excitement of doing something. I'd have to convince people with the resources, the student government, to fund me. I'd have to communicate with confidence and clarity, here's where we're going, even if I wasn't in fact that confident or clear. And I did that over and over and over again in scenarios that were very, very low consequence and internalized and got better and better and better at it. That's what I was doing when I was a teenager. I was, in college, I did say I was a geology major, but I had no aspirations of being a geologist. In some ways, I was a I majored in extracurriculars. And I don't mean like, you know, drinking and chasing women. I mean, I was taking this opportunity to do all of these things that I got to build something in a time when if I screwed it up, well, I still had a cafeteria to go to and I still had a dorm room to go back to. So this is the time. Take these chances. That's my path. Yeah. And it's amazing now because you have tools that I never had access to. I mean, because right now the technical stack is so good that if you want to start something, it's really easy. You know, you don't, if I, back then, I couldn't have done of course, the internet wasn't there, but I mean, I couldn't do a website. You know, I didn't know how to code it up myself. I couldn't buy the servers. I couldn't wire them in. I couldn't write my own payment portals. But now you don't need to do any of that stuff. You can get onto Amazon. You can use PayPal or Stripe. You can, you know, you can use a Squarespace. Everything is like, or Shopify. Everything's easy. So do something. Don't think, do something.
I love that. And I think that's a pretty great note to end on. I was going to ask you to give everyone a challenge. We've got some really excited people in the chat. They're loving what you're saying. A lot of love coming your way, Marc, but people are just really chomping at the bit to start. And I was going to challenge you to give them something to start, but I think you just said it.
Well, I'll give you something else for people to work on. It's been really effective for me. And it has its roots, I guess, in cinema. But what I find really helpful is when you're trying to accomplish something, is in your mind, I want you to make a movie, and I want you to jump forward to 2 years from now or 3 years from now and say, what's happening? Oh, I have a big successful business with lots of people and it's doing this and it's selling. But get detailed. Really picture what it looks like. But then I want you to write the movie going backwards. What are the scenes that lead up to that? It's this visualization of the intermediate steps to really get to your vision. It's super, super helpful because too many of us dream of what we think the future might hold. And I always tell people, stop dreaming, you know, but you can't help it. It's kind of what is this motivation? So instead, take that dream and write the movie backwards. What do you really have to do? And that's a conceptual version of it. And a more specific version of it, you can also try. We talked earlier in the live stream about pitching, about going into VCs. And what I've often told people to do is after you have that informational meeting with the person who might fund you, you're 9 months out, and they've said, here's what I'm looking for. What I want you to do is build the deck now. Put the numbers in. What would this business need to look like so I could present those 7 slides to that funder? And look at that slide, those set of slides, and go, what will it take me to actually get to those specific milestones? Extremely clarifying. So anyway, there's two assignments for people, and they're both about visualization and about mapping out that path between where you are now and where you want to be. And ultimately, that's all entrepreneurial is, one step after another.
That's fantastic. Well, everyone, first of all, Marc, thank you so much for doing this. We really appreciate the effort. And we appreciate all your questions, a lot of great questions. And you've got some homework to do, folks. So you better get busy. But thanks again. And want to let everyone know that we'll have a recording of this event available on all of our social channels if you want to rewatch and take notes. You could also, of course, hear more great advice from Marc on his podcast, That Will Never Work, his book. Go to his site, markrandolph.com. And we'll hope to see you again. Should we do this again, Marc?
I'd love to, Dan. I mean, I think this is fun. And I apologize to everybody that I can't run on and on and on as I'd like to. I'm just trying to keep my strength up. But you know, Dan mentioned the website. It's a brand new website. And so I'd love people to come check it out and let me know what they think. It's as an entrepreneur, my habit is to throw stuff up that's partially baked and see what happens. So this it's a work in progress. So I'd love your feedback.
I've seen a lot of it and I can vouch for it. It's great stuff. So I encourage everyone to check it out. Thanks again for joining us. Thanks for doing this, Marc. And we will see you all again next time. See you soon.
Thanks, everybody.